Well, hello, everybody, and welcome to the Rock Cats annual Hot Stove Luncheon. I'm the voice of the Rock Cats, Jeff Dooley, and thrilled to be with you here this afternoon for our sold-out event. We had to sell out. We sold out the event actually last week, the quickest time ever. So nice round of applause for all the Rock Cat fans out there. Great to see so many familiar faces and some new ones as well. And we're here to celebrate baseball with our new Major League affiliate, the Colorado Rockies. We've got some of their team personnel in from Denver and also some former Major League Baseball players with today and hopefully some future Major League ball players in this room as well. And good news that New Englanders love to hear, just 22 days until pitchers and catchers report to spring training. Certainly looking forward to that. I'd like to begin the program by introducing our head table and seated all the way to your left to right, Rock Cats relief pitcher the last 2 years, Ryan O'Rourke. Next to Ryan is our great owner of the Rock Cats, Josh Solomon. Hartford City Council President, Sean Wooden. 2015 Rock Cats Field Manager, Darren Everson. Two-time Major League All-Star and former NLCS MVP, now a host of the Rob Dibble Show here in Hartford, Rob Dibble. Senior Director of Player Development for the Rockies, Zach Wilson. The Honorable Mayor of the City of Hartford, Mayor Pedro Segarra. Closer in the Colorado Rockies system and former star at UConn, Scott Oberg. Rockcats General Manager, Tim Restall. And starting pitcher the last 3 years for the Rockcats, Pat Dean. Also like to recognize some of the city and community leaders we have with us today. Alexandra Ponte, Councilman. Eric Daniels from the Hartford Parking Authority. Michael Looney, Director of Project City of Hartford. Daryl Hill, Hartford's Chief Operating Officer. Maribel LaLuce, the Director of Communications and New City, the new media in the City of Hartford. Sarah Bronin, Chairman of Planning and Zoning Commission. Brandon McGee, State Representative. Joel Cruz, Councilman. And Thomas Deller, Hartford's Director of Development Services. I appreciate them being with us here today. Well, as the Rock Cats are set to begin their fourth season under the ownership and leadership of Josh Solomon, Josh has continued the Rock Cats' outstanding work in the community with team personnel, players, mascots making over 600 appearances locally each year. The Rock Cats continue to be the top professional sports attraction in the state of Connecticut, Western Massachusetts, and this past season set a franchise record, welcoming more than 22,000 fans over a three-game weekend, May 30th through June 1st. Josh has a great vision for this franchise as it will continue to be part of the summertime tradition here in the Nutmeg State. President and co-founder of the DSF Group, one of the preeminent multifamily developers and investors in the country, it gives me great pleasure to welcome the principal owner of the Rock Cats baseball team, Josh Solomon.
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much, Jeff. Welcome to the Hot Stove Lunch. It is great to be in the city of Hartford. We have so many exciting things planned for the city, for the upcoming season and seasons to be in Hartford. We look forward to being the franchise of this capital city. We're building something that I think all of you will be hugely proud of. It is going to be a phenomenal state-of-the-art facility, tops nationally. Understanding that we are going to have this facility and it being the preeminent ballpark, that was critical in the design of this ballpark because the city of Hartford deserves nothing less. For those of you attending the Hot Stove for the first time, this event officially kicks off the countdown to our opening of the new ballpark in April 2016. The proceeds of this event will go towards the benefit of the YMCA, the Wilson Gray YMCA. It also gives us a great opportunity to present the Triple Crown Award. This is an annual award given to the person whose work in the community has been most impactful. Let me now introduce our next speaker. We're pleased and honored today to be joined by our good friend, the mayor of the city of Hartford, Pedro Segarra. I've had the opportunity to see firsthand just how passionate and hardworking the mayor is when it comes to moving Hartford forward. Bringing baseball and new development to downtown North is not an easy task. Mayor Segarra had a vision for Hartford and worked tirelessly to achieve the approval for the stadium. He has been committed to moving Hartford forward, and we appreciate that. Mayor Segarra, proud to call you a friend and supporter of baseball, Rockcat baseball. Welcome. Thank you.
You know, it is sort of a eerie feeling that I get being here when I realize that this benefit is being done for the YMCA, which was the first home, or the first place that I called home in Hartford. And right here in this building, which is Capital Community College, which at the same time that I was at the Y, went to interview for in order to start college. So it's like the world coming full circle in sort of a strange way. One of the biggest passions about downtown North was to connect the north end of our city with the downtown. What is occurring in Hartford is not very dissimilar to what is happening in many cities around the country, where the urge for both young and old to return to the urban cores, where they can have more entertainment, more restaurants, more services, more things to enhance their quality of life, both intellectually, work-wise, and also in terms of entertainment, is a real movement, and I'm working with, for those that are from Denver, with Mayor Hancock, trying to lead the effort to restore funding to our Water and Parks Conservation Fund. Shout out to him, we just saw each other at the U.S. Conference of Mayors. This effort is significant today because it is a very good start to connecting the North End community with baseball and downtown North. And so I'm very glad that we're getting an early start on doing that, because that is significant, so that one day I can see as much optimism. The first place that I lived when I came to Hartford, the first apartment that I rented was on Garden Street. So I want to see the same level of passion that I came in to this city really wanting to move forward. I want to see that in every single young person in that neighborhood, because this has purpose, and this is really to offer a better future to the young men and young women in our city who needs development such as this one, and activities such as this one is the most. So thank you so much, Josh, and from the folks from the Written Rockcats. I want to thank my council president, because city council deserves a lot of praise for their efforts. We knew that we believed in this as a goal. The road wasn't exactly clear, but the commitment was there to support a vision of making this happen. And I'm pleased to report that I think that with the input of council president and the city council, that we've been able to really move this forward in a very nice way. I want to thank you can clap. I also want to thank Tom Deller, who he had a little bit of black hair when he came here, and I think it's all but gone now, because he's really put in a lot of work in this, as has the city administration in supporting this and everyone else. But for all the people here, thank you for supporting this event today. This is going to be the beginning of something really powerful to transform our communities by creating pathways into our neighborhoods in a way that really benefits our people. Thank you so much.
I have made many, many new friends here in Hartford since we announced the Rockettes would be coming to town. The most colorful of my new friends in Hartford is I. Charles Matthews. I. Charles cares deeply about the city of Hartford. You can clearly see this, whether it's him at the Y, him in City Hall, or just his favorite place to be hanging out, which is in downtown North. I. Charles is extremely accomplished. I. Charles is a graduate of Wesleyan University and the Cornell University School of Law. He was special counsel to the United States House of Representatives Select Committee on Assassinations for President Kennedy and Dr. King. He was vice president at Quaker Oats and held many senior positions at United Technologies during his long and illustrious career. Now, I've never known him to have a job since I've met him. And Council President Wooden can confirm that he's never known that he had a job either. In all seriousness, his commitment is unparalleled. He served on Hartford City Council twice. He served as the deputy mayor from 89 to 93. He currently sits on the board of the Wilson Gray Y and the board for the Greater Hartford YMCA. This stadium never would have been approved if it wasn't for Charles Matthews. I'm proud to call Charles a dear friend, and I am so pleased to present him with the Rockettes Foundation 2015 Triple Crown Award that's given each year to the individual that's demonstrated a deep, enduring commitment to the community. Charles, please come up. Thank you.
Thank you, Josh. Colorful, huh? This is really a great honor, and I do appreciate from Josh and Tim and Amanda and the Rockettes family. I also want to thank the mayor and the president of the council, Sean, because it's not often as a private citizen you have an opportunity to work on such a great development plan. And they both worked real hard, and I had time in my hands, and they were gracious enough to allow me to be of assistance with no pay. You got double projects. For those of you who know the city of Hartford, you'll find there are a whole lot of jobs available if you're willing to work for free. Or, as we say in the legal profession, pro bono. But I do want to thank you all. This was a great opportunity because, as Josh indicated, I was deputy mayor in the city of Hartford for a number of years back in the 80s and 90s. And while our great mayor today sold the land where the stadium will be for a dollar, I tried my best to give it away then and couldn't find anyone who would build on that land. So I really think you did a great job, Mr. Mayor. And I do think that this is a great project. It's an opportunity to do great things. Again, people talk about the ballpark, but we're also talking about a supermarket. We're talking about retail. We're talking about housing. This is a new neighborhood that will really bring vitality to this city and bring opportunities for our young folks. Great opportunity. And as I've often said in my other life as president of Wilson Gray YMCA, on Albany Avenue. We have over 4,000 young folks. And guess what? They all need jobs. So this is an opportunity to really change the fabric of this city. And Josh, I want to thank you all. Mr. Mayor, I want to thank you. President Sean, I want to thank you. Thank you all. Thank us. Thank you.
Congratulations on your terrific award. Well, our next guest comes to us from Worcester, Massachusetts. Lefty specialist who absolutely swallowed up left-handed hitters this past season. Ryan O'Rourke held lefties to a 103 batting average while striking out 41 of 68 lefties faced. That's 60% that couldn't even put the ball in play. He led the Rockettes with 50 appearances and recorded 52 strikeouts in 40 innings of work. He is Merrimack College's all-time strikeout leader and was drafted by the Twins in 2010. Ryan is very popular with our fan base, is one of the clubhouse leaders as well, donating his time off the field to visit kids at the Connecticut Children's Medical Center. Entering his sixth season of professional baseball, please welcome Rockettes pitcher Ryan O'Rourke.
Thank you, Jeff. Last year I was standing at a stage like this and was told 15 minutes prior that I needed to give a speech by Dooley, so I was given a couple weeks notice this time, so I promise it will be better. In the minor leagues, your goal is to always keep moving up until you eventually reach the MLB. No player in their right mind would ever want to repeat a level. I had a pretty good year in 2013 playing for the Rockettes and went down to spring training in 2014 and thought it was going to be in AAA, and then found out I was going back to New Britain. It wasn't a bad thing though. The only kind of disappointment I have was that I was not going to be pitching at a higher level. But I'm from Worcester, so New Britain's only an hour ride away, and Hartford's going to be even closer. So unless I get traded, I'm not going back there. What I saw with the Rockettes though is that being an hour away, it brought a sense of comfort to my game. I knew that on a Sunday, if we had a day game, I could go home and get, you know, some of my mom's lasagna after. I could go home and see my brother, my parents, and I think that really helped me and kind of embraced the Rockettes as a second home. I can't tell you how many games that my parents were able to come to. They came all my college games when I was in Merrimack, which was close, but when I was in Florida and Tennessee and Wisconsin, they don't really like to travel, so they didn't want to come see their son. I'm clearly not the favorite. Even my friends, they were able to come down and see me play, and I think that I think my friends thought I was making this whole professional baseball thing up because they hadn't seen me play in about 5 years either. So when my family would come down, they got put up in the boxes and they got to know the staff, and the will call knew them by name. I didn't even have to leave tickets for the last half of the second season because they just knew my mom was the crazy lady with the Twins gear. The little things like that made me realize that my time here was special. Many times in the minors, you look at a place as just a stop on the way to the MLB, and I didn't look at New Britain as that way. I don't look at the Rockettes as that way. I really embraced my time here. Countless times Amanda would text me in the morning or after a game saying, hey, we have a charity thing tomorrow. Do you think you can make it and round up some of the guys? Without hesitation, I wanted to do that. My first time, I got suckered into doing it, I guess you could say, because I was the new guy. And I had to go to the Connecticut Children's Hospital. Now, had to was the word that I used to use. Now I love to go to the Connecticut Children's Hospital. I love to see some of those kids. The bike giveaways that we had this year, there was maybe 50 bicycles lined up for kids aged 8 to 12, 13 years old. And then there was a 26-year-old big kid in the outfield screaming on a little 10-year-old bicycle. So all of you can have that image in your head right now. All of those events meant so much to me. From each day that I was a part of the Rockettes, I was hooked on not only expressing myself on the field, but expressing myself in the community and being a sense of Connecticut. I also look at this place as a second home. As we all walked in with our jerseys one time at Connecticut Children's Hospital, it's a moment I'm never gonna forget. We walked into a room where a boy was pretty sick and we had our jerseys on. I believe Pat was with me too, and the boy was kind of gasped and said, oh my God, the Rockettes are here. And we all chuckled, the players, and then we looked at him and he was actually crying. There was actually tears on his face of how happy he was that we were there. Now, I'm just Ryan O'Rourke, I'm just a normal kid, but when I put that jersey on, I brought someone tears of joy. So much so that I actually had to turn away because there was a couple tears running down my face. So it's touching moments like that, you know, being a part of the Rock Cats, that really I want to express to you how important it is for me. And lastly, I cannot give enough thanks to Josh, Tim, Amanda, Mike, Dooley, Pat, Ted, or Stretch as people know him, Steve, Bree, the whole staff. You all made it possible for me to have two of the best years I've ever had playing baseball. I'm forever in your debt. And to all you fans out there, without you, there's no Rock Cats. There's no me. So with that, I give you my utmost respect for coming to the games and still cheering me on after I've given up a couple game losing home runs this year. So thank you all very much.
Thank you, Ryan. Rock Cats fans certainly know our next guest. He's been up and down between the Rock Cats and AAA the last couple of years, and he's a Connecticut native. Pat Dean grew up in Naugatuck, had a wonderful career at Naugatuck High School before going on to pitch at Boston College. He was named International League Pitcher of the Week while at AAA and posted the best walks per nine inning ratio in the Eastern League in 2013. He's very durable and someone the Rock Cats staff can count on every 5 days. Pat led the Rock Cats in starts and finished second in the club in wins and innings pitched in 2014. He also showed his support in the community and was a regular visiting with the kids at the Connecticut Children's Medical Center. A third round pick in 2010 and the Rock Cats opening day starter and winner last season. Please welcome pitcher Pat Dean.
All right. Thanks, Dulles. Now, I'm not the best public speaker, so I won't keep you guys too long and talk your ear off. Ryan did a great job. And just like Ryan, I kind of want to share my experience that I've had. Being a local guy, Naugatuck, Connecticut, it's only about 30-minute trip from my house to the stadium. So for me, I've been able to play in my backyard for a few years now. And it hasn't only meant a lot to me, but to my family as well. Right? They've been able to come in and watch me pitch. People that haven't been able to see me pitch in years were able to come watch me play. So it was an amazing experience, not just for my family, but for my friends as well. And then also, for a lot of fans that were coming to the games, and I would see them out, not just at the ballpark, but like going around town, people who I've never met before would come up to me and say, you know, oh, we're following you, we're watching the newspaper, we're seeing all this stuff. So just having that support, being a local guy, and having all these people come up to me and showing that they're supporting me and supporting the Rock Cats, it's an amazing feeling. I know as a player, we're just out there playing a game, but when we see all these people that we're affecting just by going out there, you know, every night and putting the uniform on, it's a really humbling experience. And then for us to do things like going and visit the kids at the Children's Hospital and see how much we affect them, like it really is incredible to, you know, be in this position, to be in a spot where we are touching people's lives. You know, I thought I was just playing a game, but it really means so much more to so many more people. And in my experience so far, throughout my baseball career, it's been an amazing one. And I just want to thank everybody. There's so many people I could thank, and I don't want to leave anybody off the list, so I won't start naming names. So I just want everybody along the way that, you know, has been there to support me, support us on our journey. I want to thank you, and especially in the Rock Cats organization. I know you guys are, you know, onto a new journey with a new organization, and you know, me and Ryan are on a new journey as well. So we look forward to seeing what 2015 has to bring to us, and thank you.
Well, from a couple of former Rock Cats to a future Rock Cat, we're all hoping that Scott Oberg joins our club this season. He has New England roots, being from Tewksbury, Massachusetts, and playing at UConn, so our new affiliate is a perfect fit for this right-handed pitcher. Scott pitched at AA last season, was a big part of Tulsa's run to the Texas League Championship Series. He was a perfect 15 for 15 save opportunities last year and was named to the league's All-Star team. He has converted on 61 saves since being drafted by the Rockies in 2012. And he was recently listed by Baseball America as one of the top pitching prospects in the Rockies system. We're all hoping that he can suit up in a Rock Cats uniform before going on to play in the major leagues in Colorado. Please welcome pitcher Scott Oberg.
Thank you, Jeff. When I was first asked to come here to this event, you know, I was reached out by Tim, by Zach, by Amanda, and they said, you know, we'd really like to have a local guy who's familiar with the area and come in and, you know, do the press conference with the team and give a little 5-minute speech. And for me, if you don't know me, I'm not really that big of a talker. I know these guys to my right here can vouch for that. My father-in-law can probably vouch for that. And, the guy who recruited me to UConn, Justin Blood, can definitely vouch for that as well. So when they asked me to do this, I kind of thought, well, maybe I should have paid attention in my public speaking class back at UConn. But you know, basically, they just asked me to come up here, talk about my experience with UConn a little bit, and you know, that experience to me, I think, means as much to me being a former student athlete as it does to the people in Connecticut, the fans in Hartford. You know, you can see the UConn basketball team, you know, about at least once a week at the XL Center. Now we're getting into the UConn hockey a little bit more. They're playing at the XL Center. And you know, you get that big community feel because there aren't any major league teams in the state. So I think everybody really gets to rally around, you know, a team like the New Britain Rockettes or, you know, the UConn football team or the UConn basketball teams or, you know, what have you. So for me, it was a great honor to be able to play at a school like UConn and playing really great fan base, especially knowing the traditions and the deep roots that a lot of people have worked really hard for to get UConn to the point where they're at now. One of the things that really had an impact on me at school that I've taken and moved forward with me to the professional side of things is what Coach Pender's always preached since the first day that we get on campus, and that's bringing your best attitude, your best concentration, and your best effort into everything that you do, no matter whether it's on the baseball field or off the baseball field, or whether it's in a community event or whatever it is. If you're able to bring those three things every day with you to what you do, you're going to be very successful in what you're able to do, because you're working hard, you're doing the things that you have to do, and there's no, you know, you can't be at fault for working and doing your best. So I mean, for me, that kind of set the foundation moving forward into the Rockies system, and it's been a really easy transition. And these guys always, the big thing is, you know, taking pride in your career, and that was another thing that, you know, I really got to establish at UConn as well. But I think if I'm able to play in New Britain, I think that would be, you know, an absolute wonderful thing. Not only for the city of New Britain itself. I mean, like some of the other guys were saying, Connecticut's almost like a second home being from New England. You know, I grew up in Massachusetts. I got family in Connecticut, you know, being a UConn athlete. And you know, being able to come home a little bit and maybe having the potential to play in front of such a great fan base and being able to play, in, you know, in a state where I'm very familiar with would be a great opportunity, and that'd be something I'd really, really relish. So I just want to thank everybody who was able to put this event on. I want to thank my father-in-law, Greg Filipek, who was able to make the trip up with me. My wife, unfortunately, was not able to make the trip. She's working on getting her nurse practitioner's degree from the University of Pennsylvania, so she's at work right now. But I also like to thank Zach and Darren for being able to come here and asking me to be at this event. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Scott. Our next guest grew up in Connecticut before going on to pitch in the major leagues. Baseball fans remember just how dominant Rob Dibble was when he was closing games for the Cincinnati Reds. The Southington native and former first-round pick pitched for 7 seasons in the major leagues and helped the Reds win the 1990 World Series. His outstanding National League Championship Series play earned Dibble NLCS MVP. Known as one of the nasty boys, Rob was feared for his blazing fastball, which would touch 100 miles per hour on the radar gun and recorded 500 strikeouts in fewer innings than anybody who had played the game before him. After being named to 2 All-Star teams with the Reds, he went on to pitch for the White Sox and the Brewers. We're fortunate to hear Rob talk sports daily, including great Rockcats coverage as he hosts the Rob Dibble Show on ESPN Radio 97.9 and 1300 AM. Please welcome Rob Dibble.
Thank you, Jeff. Thank you, Josh. Thank you, everybody, for having me today. It's an honor to be here. Too tall for that. It's also an honor to be with Bobby. Bobby was one of my coaches with the Reds my final year in 1994. But to give you a little background for people who don't know about what it's like to come from Connecticut, you're kind of looked down upon from other guys that come from California and Texas and Florida. They almost put you down. But growing up in Southington, I had the beauty of going to the Bristol Red Sox games, the West Haven Yankee games, going to New Britain Red Sox. We had the Waterbury Indians. The minor leagues in Connecticut was one of the things that fueled me in the minor leagues. I wanted to play there someday. I recorded my high school coach's 300th victory at Muzzy Field in Bristol. It's one of the greatest honors of my young life when I was 16 years old. So from that point on, and I came through here in the Eastern League in 1986, so about 29 years ago, on my way to the major leagues, I came through here. The facilities in Britain back then were state of the art. We played on an old field up in Burlington, Vermont, where the Catamounts play, the college team. That was our AA minor league facility. So to put a facility in downtown Hartford that will be state of the art, you can't imagine what that's gonna be life for young ball players that come through here. Double A, triple A, doesn't matter. That'll be one of the best facilities to that point in their career that they'll ever play on. I played at the old Milwaukee Old County Stadium. It's like a college field. So you the support you're giving these young men sitting up here, you can't even imagine what that means to them. I spent 4.5 years in the minor leagues. Places, Cedar Rapids, Iowa, Eugene, Oregon, Tampa, Florida. I played 2 years in Nashville, Tennessee, Burlington, Vermont, Denver, Colorado with the Denver Zephyrs. Played at Mile High Stadium. One night we played in front of 74,000 people, and I knew where I wanted to play, in the major leagues. It took me 4.5 years, 2 winters in Puerto Rico to get there. And it was the greatest honor of my life. It's given me an awful lot, but it started right here in Connecticut. Spent the last year out in, or last 9 years out in California. I coached high school baseball for 3 years, but there was no place else I wanted to live than right here in Connecticut. My family's from here, Bobby's from here. And you can't imagine the drive it takes to get to the major leagues. And if I can impart that on any young kids that I'm working with now, and when you're at minor league games and you see these kids working, they're the future major leaguers. I'll never forget. I mean, I used to work Stanley in New Britain in the off season. I've worked at JCPenney in the off season. I was a security guard 3 different times in the off season. All honorable professions. But what drove me to get to the major leagues was Connecticut. And so by supporting these young men, you're giving them an opportunity that you can't imagine. It's so fleeting. Bobby and I were one of about 18,000 guys that have ever played in the major leagues. And I'm one of 140 teams that have a world championship. I played for an organization that was the oldest professional organization in the major leagues in Cincinnati. It's all about tradition. It's all about honor. It's all about pushing yourself. And to put a facility in downtown Hartford, I think is gonna be one of the most wonderful things that's ever been done for Connecticut. So you should be proud that you're going to do this. A lot of people in this room know my father. He worked in Hartford for 40 years, Walt Dibble. And the one thing my dad always taught me was, You get out of it what you put into it. My edge, and maybe why people thought I was so crazed, was I could work you to death. I could outrun you, I'll outpractice you, I'll outthrow against you, I'll outplay you. And I learned that from a man who never played a sport in his life. The greatest honor of my life was to play in the major leagues for my father. And for a lot of these young men, it's going to be an honor for them when they play in the major leagues for their parents. But it's an honor to stand up here in the fact that you people are going to build a stadium that these guys can go out and play and dream of playing in the major leagues someday. So thanks for having me, and thanks for putting the stadium in downtown Hartford.
Thank you, Rob, and Rob's a treat to listen to each day on radio. We have a long history of managers that have done outstanding work with our organization, role models for the players, friendly with our great fans, and the face of the ball club. Down Everson was named the 16th manager in Rockcats franchise history by the Rockies earlier this winter. This will be his third season in the Rockies system after serving as the hitting coach of the Tulsa Drillers the past 2 years. He recently managed the Washington Wild Things of the Independent Frontier League and also managed two stops in the Marlins system. We're looking forward to him guiding the Rockcats this season. Darren, a former first baseman and catcher, played minor league baseball for 7 seasons. We're thrilled to have with us the new manager of the Rockcats baseball team. Please welcome Darren Everson.
Thanks, Julian. Thanks for everyone being here. This is great. I'm going to do the same thing. I don't want to bend over the whole time while I'm trying to talk to you guys here. So, what a great great facility, great just representation of the area. We're very excited to be here. A couple things that are going to be unique. Obviously, when we come in as a National League team, you're going to see some National League stuff happening. We're excited about that. We're excited about giving it a little bit different brand of baseball that way. And we try to figure out why I'm taking two guys out in the seventh inning or something like that as we go forward, and it'll be a unique situation with National League rules coming into play. I'm from Wisconsin. I know the weather a little bit. I actually drove from Wisconsin into Madison, and then I went from here and been through the weather. I wasn't sure if we were going to make it when I saw the big storms on the Weather Channel and all that stuff, but luckily we made it in, and which was great to hear, great to see. We're going to be cold in April, which is going to be interesting for some of our guys, and we're excited about getting up here in April and getting that started. And being a northern guy, we'll prepare them as well as we can and come up with our warm weather up here, and we're excited to be a part of that. A couple unique things that you'll see on our field this year, and we're very excited to be in New Britain, and then the following year being in Hartford, it's going to be great. But one thing that's new for a lot of you guys that you'll see, new for us and new for me this fall, was when I was in the Arizona Fall League, we had a 20-second shot or pitch clock, as you want to call it. We called the shot clock at the time during the Fall League. So our pitchers now are going to have 20 seconds to get rid of that baseball, basically. And one thing that you'll see, I'm curious to see where they put the 20-second pitch clocks at, to see as we go through. But I'm also curious, and I can imagine Rob being out there closing and somebody counting down like 5, 4, 3, and how that would actually affect the pitcher and what we're going to be seeing with that as we go forward. In the Fall League, there's about 30 people in the stands. We didn't have to worry about that. So what's going to be interesting is as we go and we play in certain venues, maybe even our venue, as that clock runs down, what that process might be and what it might develop into as we go forward into that level of the game, trying to get the game a little bit quicker, kind of get the in-between innings. We're going to have times as well, which is not an issue with us, with the Rockies. We value the time and value the kids out there as they go out, and sprinting on and off the field is one thing that we definitely are a part of. They wanted me to talk a little bit about with what to expect from me managing, the managing style. We're going to try to be aggressive. We're going to try to have as much fun out there as we can. We love to have pitchers. Hopefully that will attack the zone, that will be out there and trying to attack all the time in terms of the hitter's weaknesses, but also going through our pitcher's strengths. Offensively, we're going to have some movement. We're going to have some people running out there and trying to, as we can with our speed and as much speed as Zach allows us to have, we're going to be moving and trying to get people in the area and creating some holes for some people as we go forward. And then it's just a matter of allowing our players to play through their strengths. I talk about that a lot. If we can do that, which I think the organization with the Rockies, it's been a great 2.5 years right now with the Rockies since I've been there. And the people that are there, it's an amazing thing that how we talk about family. And when I was interviewed 2 years ago with Zach and Jeff, and one of the things that I always came back with to my wife, Terry, was how much they talked about family, how concerned they were about me, our family, our kids, how it tied into the Rockies way, how it tied into what we expect and what we want out of our coaches and coordinators, how we teach the game, trying to be that side of it, trying to be a teacher of the game, trying to develop our players to the best of their ability, and then allowing them to win. Giving them the tools to be consistent is how we go forward, but then for all 25 players when it goes to 7:05 to try and go win games, which is sometimes a unique thing in the development process of minor league baseball. And that was one of the things I loved about it, was the family atmosphere that they created even through the interview process. And now the last 2 years being a part of it and being a part of that family, being a part of the Rockies family, it's been great. It's been absolutely wonderful. And now being tied in, and Zach calls me about a month ago and said, hey, we're going up to New Britain into Hartford to do the hot stove banquet. I said, that sounds great. And in talking to Zach about the front office here, the ownership here, who I had not met yet, and how much they had talked, or how Zach had talked about how they were so much family orientated, how we're trying to get this thing going, and when the stadium comes, it's going to be just a booming thing, and what they already do at the field, and what they try to do in terms of the community, making it a family atmosphere, making it an atmosphere that's really fun for the players and the fans and the little ones that are out there trying to, you know, play in their youth baseball, youth softball type games. And so now to be able to tie in the Rockies organization that I've been with now, this will be my third year, and then to tie it in with the family atmosphere here with the Rock Cats and with New Britain and here in the next year in Hartford, it is going to be an outstanding, I think, marriage and an outstanding combination of becoming a family and getting out in the community and being that part of, you know, drawing in that part of the game so we can actually make an impact on other people's lives as well. The platform that we're given is an amazing thing as long as we do amazing things with it. And so that's what we're looking forward to do. I'm excited to be here, and we're looking forward to the family atmosphere, the fans, the ownership, the front office, and thank you for everything that you've already given me in the few hours we've met and known each other, and we're looking forward to a great season. Thank you.
Thank you, Darren. We certainly look forward to your brand of Rockheads baseball this season. We have with us today one of the great treasures the state has produced, one of the finest athletes to ever come out of Connecticut, an all-state baseball, football, and track star. From Stanford out to Los Angeles and then circling back to New York, there hasn't been much that Bobby Valentine has not done in the game of baseball. He played in the major leagues with the Dodgers, the Angels, the Padres, the Mets, and Mariners. And he managed in the major leagues with the Rangers, the Mets, and the Red Sox. He's managed in Japan. He's broadcasted in the big leagues. Now he's doing a wonderful job as the executive director of athletics at Sacred Heart University in Fairfield. Please welcome someone that has made Connecticut very proud, Bobby Valentine.
Thanks, Jeff. An honor to be with you today, Mr. Mayor, and members of the community. You're talking about minor league baseball. You're talking about bringing something to your community that's really special. And as Rob alluded to, and as Scott and Ryan and Pat conveyed to you, their life in the cities that they live in while they're earning a living and fulfilling their dreams becomes a major part of their life. And I can tell you, it's not a part of the life that gets disconnected. I played in a little town of Ogden, Utah in 1968, and a town of Spokane, Washington in 1969 and 70. I could tell you today that I still have friends in those communities. I return to those communities. I have two people who work for me since 1980 from those communities, and we've worked together at with different projects, and in particular a restaurant that we just opened here in Windsor Locks, a fellow friend of mine from Spokane, Washington, that I met in 1969, is part of that development of that project. So what you're doing is not only building it so they will come, you're building it so that they will stay. And they'll leave a lasting impression on your community. And as was displayed by Pat and Ryan and Scott and Rob, who's now has such not national prominence, that the people who play in your community give your community credit. They will make Hartford proud that they came through here. They will make Hartford proud that they had an opportunity to earn a living here, and your kids and your grandkids will be able to establish cherished memories. I could tell you that as recently as last year, I got a letter from a doctor who is now 52 years old, who thanked me for the time he came to Spokane, Washington to a baseball game, and I took the time out before the game to pat this little guy on the head and wish him the best and tell him about the wonderful R's of responsibility and respect and reality. And the memories that are created on the field are also memories that are created off the field. So all I could say is, a guy who was born in Connecticut, grew up in Connecticut, I have my whole and I'll be in the ground someday in Connecticut, that Hartford, you did good. You did really good, and I'm proud to say that I'm a nutmegger and that I will always be a proud resident of the state of Connecticut, and I'll be really happy to sit at a ballpark in a state-of-the-art stadium in the capital of one of the great states of America, Hartford, Connecticut. So thank you very much for what you're doing. Anything you ever need, just call. Thank you.
Thank you, Bobby. We're excited to have with us another member of the Rockies family, the man responsible for all the player moves and rosters at the minor league level, Senior Director of Player Development, Zach Wilson. This is Zach's 13th season with the Rockies and his first in his new role with the club. He had previously served as Assistant Director of Player Development in the organization and played a key role as the Rockies were named the Topps Organization of the Year in 2013. Zach was kind enough to join us from the snow of Denver to the snow of Hartford. Please welcome our guest speaker and Rockies Senior Director of Player Development, Zach Wilson.
Thank you, Jeff. Scott Oberg, you do talk. You're not a mute. This is a first for me. You know, when I heard that Bobby was going to be here today, I just heard yesterday, I know you were a late addition, and so I talked to Tim Restall and I said, well, can I just make a left-hand turn now in Denver? If I fly, I don't need to be here anymore. Bobby's here. So really, really happy to have you here, though, Bobby, and everyone that spoke. You know, when I do these things, I like to start off with a little story. And there were two guys, they were talking about baseball, two players. And they were talking about whether or not there was baseball in heaven. And so they debated about this and made an argument, got in a big argument about it, actually, and finally came to the conclusion, you know what, when the first one dies, they'll come back and they'll tell the other one whether or not there's baseball in heaven. Many, many years passed, and one of them eventually passed and went up to heaven. And of course, there's baseball up in heaven. So he comes back down, and he tells his buddy, he says, I got good news and I got bad news. There is baseball in heaven, but you're scheduled to pitch on Thursday. You know, first I want to thank, first of all, the city of Hartford for setting up this event, and the Rock Cats. Josh and his brother Jim and Jennifer, the ownership group, they've really just embraced us as the Rockies organization with open arms. And Tim and his staff, they've been outstanding. And you know, when we
separated from the Tulsa Drillers, this is really one of the first places we looked for a lot of good reasons. We had heard a lot about the organization and the people that ran this organization. We heard a lot about this community and what you guys in this room are trying to do. And obviously we caught wind of the new stadium and the development that's going to go on here real soon. And all these things were very, very appealing to us. And we hopped on a call with Josh and Tim, and it was kind of an instant back and forth relationship, and it was very easy to see that we were going to go along very well. And it didn't take us long to come to the conclusion that this is where we wanted to be. And so we're very thankful for them embracing us the way that they have. Certainly need to thank some other people in the room, Mr. Mayor and Tom, I know you're out there, and the President of the City Council for all their efforts in making this stadium a reality. And, you know, people talked about it up here, but when a player who's 20, 21, 22 years old walks out into a brand new stadium and sees a second deck and sees a beautiful playing surface, I can't tell you how that changes the way they look at the game mentally. To know that they get to walk out in front of 5,000 or 10,000 people in a beautiful new ballpark and play in front of a group like that and get to go down to a clubhouse where they have all the amenities and everything they need to become the best player they can be. It's an unbelievable thing that you're doing for these players. And right now, you probably don't see that. But when those guys step out there for the first time and we cut that ribbon, you're going to feel that. You're going to feel that. You know, part of my job, and Jeff alluded to this, I've got 200 players that I'm responsible for across America in our 7 different affiliations, which includes the Dominican Republic. In fact, I flew here from the Dominican Republic, so I went from tank tops to parkas in a big hurry. But one of the things that I talk to our players a lot about is having fun. I'm a fun guy. I love to joke around. I joke around with our players a lot. A lot of that I do to earn their trust. Scotty can tell you that I have probably the best or the worst sarcasm in the organization, depending on how you look at it. But at the end of the day, my job is to inspire. It's to inspire our players. I've hired guys like Darren to teach them how to play the game and how to become a major leaguer. My job is to inspire. What you've done in this room by creating this beautiful new stadium that we're going to have next year and expanding the development to other areas of this community, that's an inspiration. That's an inspiration to a lot of other cities who don't have a ballpark like we're about to build. And as I said, it's certainly an inspiration to our players. Since I just came from the DR, I'll tell you a little bit about my experiences there every time I go down there, because it fits right into what's going on here. In the DR, if you've never been down the Dominican, Bobby, I know you've been there several times. It a lot of people don't realize this. It's a third world country, and so you'll be driving. You'll be terrified, but you'll be driving on the highway, and you'll see an open lot of grass, and there's kids, young kids, just playing, throwing around a baseball. No bases, no home plate, no fence, grass, usually with trash in it. And so whenever I go down there, I see these things. And we're fortunate enough to have built a brand new complex down there last year. So our players are blessed in that way, but there's a lot of people down there that aren't blessed. I visit, when I'm down there, at least 2 or 3 of our players' homes. They come from cement floors and they come from tin roofs. And there's no bedrooms and there's no refrigerator and there's no water, there's no electricity that stays on for 24 hours at a time. And they have to deal with all these factors in their life. And yet they still
find ways to play this game that we all love. And they still find ways to keep a passion and an energy for that game. And I'm blessed to be able to travel down there because, and I love to do it this time of year, because it re-energizes me every year to see how they look at the game, to see how they play the game, to see how they go about having passion and playing it with fun and with no worries. And they inspire me when I go down there. And so ultimately my job is to take that inspiration that I get from them and so many other areas in life, and particularly baseball life, and spread that inspiration to our coaching staff and to our players. And I know that when Darren fields his team here in New Britain this year and in Hartford next year, that you're gonna see that. And my hope is that their inspiration of how they show up to the yard every day to have fun, number one, to become the best they can be as men and as players, number two, and as inspirers to the people in the stands, number three. And I'm hopeful that just like I fall in love with the game every time over and over again when I go down to the DR, that our players will allow you in that beautiful new stadium in 2016 to fall in love with the game over and over and over again. Thank you for having me. Congratulations on the new stadium, and we look forward to 2015.